Hello and welcome to another day in no man's land. It's not too bad now because it hasn't rained for a few days, so it's all dry. But yeah, instead of mud, glorious mud, you get wind blasted with dust. And the wind's coming from that direction, so it has all this length to pick up dust. And you absolutely get covered in the stuff. Yes, today's video. How to unload these ISO veyor containers. 30 foot long, 34 gross ton weight. Currently they get loaded with about 24, 25 tons worth of ash. And then we take it down to wherever. It used to come from that power station, but that one's decommissioned, so it comes from several 100 miles north now, via train, hence all the train tracks over there. So this is the working side. The other side doesn't have any of these pipes and whatnot, but this is where all the unloading is done. So you've got two lines. Charge, air in, pressurization, whatever you want to call it, up front. And then round the back is a little bit wider discharge line, and that's where all the material goes up a big pipe and into this massive 100 foot high 140 ton silo where it's all stored. So because of health and safety, I can't do it on site obviously, but you will just have to use your imagination. So I've slid the trailer in to make it short. There's some railings here, big 100 foot high watsits. There's some compressors just over here and some pipe work that comes around the front. So open this, whack your pipe on there, bring it round the back, stick your pipe onto the old discharge line there. Then grab your compressor line and whack that on there. These are for a spanner, but they're usually pretty loose. You can do them by hand. Yes, this tank, the way it discharges is it uses air pressure. It's all done with air. So you blow air up through all the stuff to make it all light and fluffy so that it behaves like a liquid instead of a solid. And then you charge it down the line and up into the old tank. So this is our thing here, 2 bar, whatever that is, maximum allowed working pressure. There's all our weights and whatnot. Max gross 34 tons, tear weight 2.7. So we've got all these lines here. So once we're all connected up, ready to go, we need to get it set up. So what we've got here, this is called a ring jet, and that bypasses all the pipe work, feeds air into here, down into the pipe. That's if you get a blockage, because it can sometimes happen. Now the levers for the various bits inside this tank, it's all one big unit, it's all open, there's no baffles or anything, but there are these hemispherical aeration beds, and there's 3 of them, and they've divided them up and called them tanks, even though it's not technically a tank because it's all just one big tank. So you've got tank 3, aeration bed valves, left and right, and this is the discharge valve for tank 3. Aeration left and right for 2, discharge for number 2. Top air, that blows air around the front and up into the top of the tank to help it pressurize up a bit faster. Vent valve, because you're not allowed to drive with this pressurized. Obviously, if you have an accident and it ruptures, it's going to go off like a small bomb. So vent the air and it just comes out of this muzzle there. Aeration tank 1, right and left. Boost valve, that's the discharge of tank 1. Boost valve goes into the end of here, and then as the material's discharging, just to help it along, you put some raw air into the pipe and it just shoves it all along and up into the old and stops it from blocking the pipe, in theory. So once we're all hooked up, That is closed. That open, that open, that open, that open, that open, closed, open, open, closed. So all your aeration beds are open, your valve shut, top air's open. Fire up the old compressor. These gauges should then start building up. This is your line pressure, pressure in this line here. And this is your tank pressure. That's the more important one to pay attention to. That's the pressure in there. Once the pressure gets up to just over 1 bar, close aeration for tank one, and you close the aeration for tank two. You leave these two open, leave that open, leave that closed. You then open up the boost valve just a little bit so we hear air hissing through. And then you open discharge line two, and that should all start sending stuff down there. In the meantime, keep your eye on this. Make sure the pressure's not dropping. If it drops towards 1 bar, you risk getting a blockage. There's hatches on top as well. Sometimes they can leak, and sometimes stuff can leak out around the joins and the thing. There's also some lights up here. And if an alarm goes off because it detects anything's gone wrong, like the silo's full or there's a problem, an alarm goes off, so you have to keep walking down here to check that's not gone off. Feel your pipe to check it's vibrating and the stuff's still going through. After about 20 minutes or so, all of this middle one would have emptied out and the two end ones would sort of be falling into the middle and half emptying. So that's why you do the middle first, because the two end ones collapse into the middle. So once that's done, shut that off, and you know it's done because the old pressure will start dropping as there's not any material to add back pressure. So once that starts dropping, you know this is empty. Shut it. Tank three, because we unload the back one next, so open those two aeration bed valves, close these two. Now we unload the back before the front, because if there's a problem during the discharge and we need to shut it all down, we prefer to have weight over the drive axles than over the back, because it makes for a very interesting ride otherwise. So with these three now, two now open, open up number three and off it goes. Again, keep your eye on the old pressure. It should be up towards the 2 bar mark when it's going good. If it does get too high, the old compressor's got a relief valve on it, and there's one there as well in case it doesn't work. So again, we're pacing up and down, checking all the stuff's moving, checking the pressure, checking if the alarm's gone off. When this one empties out, the pressure will suddenly drop really fast because there's nothing falling into this one, so it just the last of it goes out and you hear a big whoosh as just air all rushes out and the pressure just drops really fast. So quickly shut that one to keep your pressure. You're going to open up number one now, both of those valves. Shut these two. The hard hat nearly went flying. And then number one, open that one up and off it goes. Again, keep an eye on the pressure, keep feeling the pipe to make sure it is moving, and keep an eye on the alarm. Once that one empties out, shut it off. Open up the middle one again, number two, left and right. Close these ones, because whilst the end ones have been unloading, more stuff would have been falling into the middle. So there'll be another couple of ton in here. So open this one up again and start discharging. So the middle one first time round takes about 20 minutes. They're about 10 minutes each. And then it's all falling into the middle. This probably takes about 5 minutes or so, if that. Once that pressure starts to go again, shut this, leave these two open, open up the left one there, open up the left one on number one. And then just quickly double check all your valves. So you open that up and you should hear it go whoosh, as there's no material in there. and it's just air rushing through. Again, check that one, big whoosh of air, nothing more. And then do number two one last time, big whoosh of air, nothing there. Good. Now, to prevent any disasters, which can happen, because none of these things have non-return valves, so if you turn the compressor off without setting it up just right, all the stuff inside will go back through the airline and ruin the compressor, which happened twice just before I started here, and that's about £2,500 per compressor to refix. So you don't want to make that mistake. So everything with a non-return valve gets closed. So that's already closed. Make sure they're closed, make sure they're closed. Keep that one open, valve. You can open that one because we don't need air in there anymore, so start venting the air. Close both of those, open then up a bit further because it's got a non-return valve. Make sure all your stuff's shut. Turn off the compressor. And then you come back, check the line pressure, make sure that's reading naught. So if there's pressure in here, when you take this line off, it's going to blast it into your face and take off all your teeth and whatnot. So that's what that one's for, to make sure that's down. So once you've got that line off, you can then shut these two, your top air and your boost valve, and then you can disconnect your discharge line as well. Put that away, put the caps back on, don't forget to do that, otherwise you get charged about 10-15 quid per one that you lose. And then that's pretty much it. You just keep, that should still be hissing. Make sure everything's horizontal during travel, that's how it should be. And yeah, that's basically how you discharge. Easy. Now, there's only a few minor problems. I've mentioned a couple. If you leave these valves open and turn off the compressor, it would all flow back through the system and ruin it. Although they have fitted non-return valves now at last, they've learnt their lesson down by where the compressors are, so that shouldn't happen anymore. Also, blockage in the pipe. There's two ways of clearing it. There's the nice easy way, and there's the hard way. The easy way, stop the discharge, because you don't want to add any more material than there already is. Shut the boost valve off so this discharge line loses its pressure. And then the ring jet, you're going to open it to add pressure and then shut it to let it ease off, and that jiggles the ash back and forth in the pipe, and eventually it will clear it and you'll see the pipe kick up and make a fuss and be all over the place, and finally it will clear. The other way of doing it, if you've got a massive blockage and that won't clear it, you've got to shut everything down, so close all the valves and whatnot, shut the compressor off, vent all the air out of this, and then what you're going to do is you're going to fire the compressor back up and charge this line, the discharge line, full of air. So you're going to open up the boost valve fully, pressurize this line, then quickly open up one of the discharge things, and the vacuum should cause everything to rush back into the tank and it sucks all the ash back up. I haven't had to do that yet, I've been lucky. I've been able to get away with just using the old ring jet and sometimes the boost one as well, if this one's not working. If it's blocked all along the line, then you use the boost one at the end, it starts slowly sucking it backwards. But yeah, I haven't had to use that method yet, and hopefully I won't have to. Another problem, I had a minor one. This ash, as it comes down this pipe, it's a rubber one, so it does slowly wear it away from the inside. I had a weakness formed up here, a bit of the pipe blew out, and a small hole formed in it, and I had a little 4-5 foot fountain of ash coming out. So again, shut the discharge, clear the line, shut everything down, change the pipe. Worst case scenario, you have a complete rupture of the pipe and you end up dumping a load of ash everywhere on the floor. Other minor problems, handles can get stuck or whatever, or break. Had some stiff handles, but I haven't had nothing break yet. I don't think there's anything else major. Yeah, split pipes and blockages are your biggest worries, really, I think. Caution hot stickers. This is compressed air in here. When you compress air, it gets hot. This makes for a nice hand warmer on a cold day. Put your hands on it, get them warm, all lovely. And that is about it. Yeah, it takes about 40 to 50 minutes. It depends on the ash, really, because it varies in consistency quite a lot. Sometimes it's nice and fluffy and dry and it just fires out. Other days it seems to, I don't know if it's got damp or something, it's a bit sticky and it hangs around a bit and it blocks constantly and it's just a pain in the backside. But yeah, it looks complicated, there's lots of levers, but it's all fairly easy, really. Don't let the pressure drop, basically, and keep your eye and make sure it's flowing, and that's about it. So, until next time, see you then.